I want to read a few verses and say just a few short things. And every time I stand here, I hope that we will remember that it's not about the messenger, but it is about the message. I also hope that when we leave this place today, that we won't say that it was good for somebody else who should have been here, not for us. But that whatever happens and transpires in this house today was for us specifically. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, "And we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. Or if we are of sound mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to what? The flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled himself, us to himself through Christ Jesus, and has given us the ministry of what? Reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of what? Reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf to be what? Reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Suppose I were to convince you today that status means nothing. This might be mind-blowing, mind-altering to some of you who are moving up the ranks in your jobs, planning in the future for the amount of education that you will have, your undergraduate, your college diploma, your master's, your PhD, then some additional certification. Suppose I told you that none of that matters to God. Suppose I could also convince you this morning, or this afternoon rather, that worst or best case scenario, you will always be for it because it's Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and then maybe one of us if we find a way to squeak through. Suppose I told you that the mark of whether or not Christ is living in us, the hope of glory, isn't who we are when we are at our best, but it is whether or not people can truly say we are Christians. Suppose I were to tell you that it really doesn't matter how much your shoes cost, or your suit, or your dress, or your handbag, or your hat, or your glasses that tint when you come inside the building. What if I could convince you that none of that matters to God? It would be tough for us to move beyond this Sabbath then, because if none of those things matter to God, what really does? In my mind, I'm looking and I'm seeing, and of course, I'm not from the Middle East, but I'm trying to picture what it looks like to be a disciple in the room with Christ. And you'll always hear me talking about the table, because at the table, both here now and back then, that is a place of reconciliation where individuals who are stretched and pulled apart, when they come to the table in the Middle East, it's always a sign that all bets have been paid off. So how then, as a disciple, do you come in the presence of the only one that understands how to fix your infirmities, the only one that can take your sins, nail himself to the cross, and say, all bets are done? How do you spend your time arguing about who will be the greatest? Unfortunately for the disciples, when they're sitting at the table, they don't have Paul sitting there with this particular writing. But if they were there, what if they really understood that in order to be an ambassador for Christ, you must negotiate him and not yourself? The longer I live, I realize that Christians, people who mean well or say that they mean well, they often gauge your Christianity based on themselves. And if you have a challenge that they don't have, somehow you take a diminished role and they are elevated. But what if we truly put ourselves in the presence of Christ and weighted our lives based on him and not who you want to be like? Ambassadors. Well, what is an ambassador? Before we step to the table today, maybe I should tell you that the ambassador isn't so much what you think it is in technical terms. An ambassador for somebody in the Bible sense is one who sits on the other side of the table and negotiates on behalf of the one who has sent them. Christians are supposed to be individuals who sit now as if it is Christ living in them, and they are negotiating, and the only thing they have is to say that, look at who I am now that I found Christ, join me in this journey. So you don't want to say amen to that, because how many of us in the room today are truly qualified to stand in the presence of others and petition on behalf of God? If we really thought we were sinners, we would be very careful as we tread towards this table today. Paul reminds us that the ministry that we ought to have isn't just giving out food, it isn't just praying for somebody, but it's reconcilers, one with God and then with each other. So let me tell you what I always say, because we don't got this thing right yet. And I already know that somebody's already upset, because you want me to talk about the lashes on his body. You want me to talk about the crown and the nails in his hand. I get you, maybe next message. But for right now, how do we come to the table as ambassadors when we still can't say good morning with love in our heart for our brother and sister that we can see? So usually I would say to you on a Sabbath morning, for those of you that are visitors, that I am in a good mood. But today I'm not in a good mood, because we still don't understand this thing called reconciliation. Reconciliation isn't when you pretend to like somebody, but deep down you dislike them, but you don't tell them why you dislike them. Reconciliation says that you go before whomever it is and you hash it out. And you say you're sorry if you're wrong. And if the person apologizes, you let it go, because only those individuals can sit on behalf of Christ. Why does Paul want us to reconcile? Paul wants us to reconcile, because he doesn't want anybody to be left behind. That's the gospel. No man left behind. How do I know this? Well, there's a story in the Gospel of Mark, 2nd chapter. There's a man who is lying down on his back, unable to walk, unable to do for himself, and he has four friends. You've already heard the story, so let me fast forward so I can help us today to understand. Four friends outside of the house, which means they're not currently in the building right now, but they have somebody in mind that they want to bring to Christ. But when they get to the door, it's packed for communion, it's packed for music day, it's packed because there's a guest speaker. But many of us will never get out of the way, because the truth is, we don't want outsiders to reconcile with God. So friends who are not in the house will have to dig their way through to bring somebody to Christ, because we refuse, because of ego, to get out of the way. And so they dig their way through, and they lower the man into the presence of Jesus. And for those of you that are struggling with whether or not you should continue to go to a church, because somebody refuses to let you off the hook for something that you've done 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60, 65, 70 years ago, come to the foot of Jesus. Lowers him down. Stops the service. Stops preaching. Stops expounding the word of God, and he is the flesh. And somehow he figures out Jesus I'm talking about. He understands that sometimes it's not about the sermon, it's how you treat people who cannot help themselves. You know what I wish? I wish we would stop playing church. I wish we would stop waiting for our item in the program so that we can go up, do our part, and sit down. I wish it would stop. I wish we would stop tearing people down that are trying, while we observe them putting an effort, but we're not doing it. I wish we would stop. Because if we started to do that in this church, every time we came to communion, we would be excited, because we would not be divided, because we would have reconciled before communion. Preach, black man, preach. Let me just come down for today. Because this is not going to be like every other communions where we go through the form and the fashion. Visitors and church members, what I want to tell you is that the ministry that Christ has given to us is one of reconciliation. How do you work with each other when you don't like each other? How do you pray for somebody you don't like when they don't even know that you don't like them? How do you sing and harmonize and put words together and slew them when you don't believe it, because it says forgive? Why is he so upset? And I am allowed to be angry every now and then. I'm angry this afternoon because we forgot the point of church. Church was never about items on a sheet. It was never about the praise team or the benediction or the invocation or the children's story or the offering. It was always supposed to be about Christ. And on this communion Sabbath, here's what I'm trying to tell you, church. The spaces that are in between us represent the relationships that we have not tried to mend. Because when you say you're sorry, when you've done something wrong to somebody, they will have no choice but to join you in worship because Christ is the even place. So my brother, I know I was smiling during the foot washing, but my heart has been heavy all week. Because there are individuals that need to be here in this place, but they won't come because they're not sure if we'll forgive them for the sins they committed 60 years ago. But Jesus, at the communion service, is the only one that's ready for foot washing. How do I know that? Because Jesus understood that in order for them to embrace him, he had to become sin so that he could become one of them, so that we can become one of him. Church, today when you partake of this thing, there has to be one person out there that you remember as I'm talking that needs to hear you say you're sorry. If you say to them that you are sorry, even if it wasn't your error, their eyes and their hearts may be turned back to God. But if you decide today that you will continue to play church and satisfy the bare minimum which is coming into the house, knowing that after the church service is done, you will already be annoyed based on what you're anticipating somebody will do, then you will have missed the reason for communion. We cannot, hear me, continue to come and play church when the end is coming. We cannot continue to go through the form and fashion of church knowing that Christ has already died for all of our sins. And the Word of God says that while we were yet sinners, he died. So if you really want to have meaning to what we're doing today, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Because one of these days when you come back, when Jesus comes back, he's not going to ask you, did you learn how to perform? That's why flesh means nothing to God. That's why character means everything to God. Because he doesn't care about who knows how to perform the best. What he's looking for is heart transformation. So let me tell you how I know this. This week for my birthday, my wife took me to a place with a simulated, skydiving type of thing. I'm not crazy, I'm not gonna jump out of a plane, but certainly I can go inside of some type of an encasement and let the wind blow on me, Sister Hampton. Before we went into this simulated place, the instructor told us what we had to do. He said, you gotta relax. You gotta stretch your legs out. You have to have your hands at a certain angle so that when the wind begins to blow, you will float. I watched every single child go before me, floating, spinning, upside down, going up and down. Then it was my turn. When I went in there, immediately the instructor said to the guy that was controlling the air, he says, turn up the air. I remembered what he said. I tried it. And we have a video that shows I failed miserably. Spent most of my time on the grid because either my legs were not straight enough or my arm was, I looked ridiculous. After my second go around, when he realized I'm not gonna get it, he said to me, "Do you wanna go up?" I was hesitant because it's 30 feet up in the air. I said, "Yes, take me up." He took everybody up, but I wanted to go up because I was tired of flying low. Please don't miss the point. When he asked me if I wanted to go up, we were still in the same condition that I couldn't fly in. Nothing changed. Same air, same uniform, same helmet, same space. I couldn't do it because I was fighting the air. What are you saying, Pastor Anderson? The instructor is the Word of God. The air is the Holy Spirit. We will never be able to fly when we fight against God. Ask Him to help us to reconcile, and we will fly. You know what the problem was? The instructor was trying to get my attention, but I thought I knew so much that I didn't need his help. We will never reconcile by a help book or somebody else's advice. We will reconcile when we begin to use this. And when we use this, the Spirit of God will carry us to places that currently we're flopping on. So as we come to the table, church, remember, it's not about the performance. We're not actors in a play. We're worshipers in need of God. Amen.